is the first Sunday after the church's celebration of the Epiphany. Some seasons of the church year are well known and household words in the culture, even among the unchurched and people from other faith traditions, other world religions. Everyone, for example, has heard of Christmas and Easter, and perhaps even the season of Lent. But the season of Epiphany is a different story. And I suspect the word Epiphany falls into that insider language category called religious jargon. The word Epiphany itself means manifest, show forth, reveal, make known. For example, Jesus is an epiphany of God as he makes God known. He reveals God. No less true, however, Jesus is an epiphany of humanity as he reveals what it is to be fully human. Fully divine, fully human, Jesus is an epiphany of both. Now, on this first Sunday after the Epiphany, we celebrate the baptism of our Lord. Every year we do that. And so the church designates this day as an especially appropriate day to celebrate the sacrament of baptism. Today at All Saints, we're celebrating both baptism. I think one of our baptismal candidates is singing over here. We're celebrating baptism. Don't worry, it's good. And also the sacrament of confirmation. Now, confirmation is grounded in baptism, as is ordination for that matter. So I would like to say three things this morning about baptism. And certainly there are more than three things to say. But this morning I'll limit my remarks to three. After all, we are Trinitarians. Now first, today's baptismal candidates, and all Christians for that matter, are grafted into the risen body of Christ as living members of the body. And as the Apostle Paul tells us, each one of us has particular gifts, and each one of us is equally valued and equally needed. Second, and believe me, the first one's the short one. Second, all baptized people are called into the body of Christ for a purpose beyond ourselves. And that's to participate in God's mission, to restore humankind to union with God and each other, to holy communion, we might say. And we participate in God's mission by revealing God. In other words, the church is called to be an epiphany of God, to be outward visible signs of Christ to the world, to be an epiphany people. And to be an epiphany people, we are called to embody the love of Jesus, a love offered without conditions, to embody the grace of Jesus, unmerited, unearned grace, to embody the forgiveness of Jesus, who forgives from the cross before we apologize, before anyone makes their confession, before anyone repents, Jesus forgives, to embody the compassion of Jesus, who touches the leper, to embody the justice of Jesus who seeks a just world, to embody the mercy of Jesus for when we fail, to be the good news of God's love in the flesh. So that second one is kind of our marching orders in a sense. The third is really what compels us to do it, the why. At baptism, what was true all along is made known. Specifically, today's baptismal candidates, along with you and me, are children of God. Moments ago, we heard the story of the baptism of Jesus. When Jesus was baptized by John in the River Jordan, as the story is told in Luke's gospel, crowds came out to be baptized by John. Matthew says the people of Jerusalem and all Judea were going out to him. And Mark says people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to John and were baptized by him in the river. So crowds, multitudes, are being baptized by John in the Jordan River for the repentance of sins. And Jesus, who had no reason to repent, and who could have watched from the riverbank, could have stood on the sidelines, steps into that river with the multitudes. Jesus chooses to be baptized, chooses to be in solidarity with the multitudes, to be in solidarity with you and me. And then, when Jesus is baptized and is coming up out of the water, the voice from heaven proclaims, and we heard this moments ago, "You are my son, the beloved. With you, I'm well pleased." Before Jesus begins his public ministry, before Jesus suffers, before Jesus dies on the cross, before Jesus accomplishes what he was born to accomplish, the voice proclaims that this is my son with whom I'm well pleased. What was true all along is made known. This is God's son. And those words are meant for today's baptismal candidates and you and me. You are God's daughter. You are God's son. What was true all along is made known to us. Which is the definition of an epiphany. You are created in God's image. True all along and proclaimed at baptism. And that's important. And I'm going to give two reasons this morning as to why I believe it's so important to know at the cellular level, to know deep in our bones that we are God's children, that you are God's child. Now these two reasons come from an author and I believe rising theologian named Glennon Doyle Melton. She's best known for her book, Carry On Warrior, and her blog called Momastery. Some of you are familiar with her, as I think that All Saints actually had a book study last year on her book, Carry On Warrior. At any rate, she writes this. She says, "I am confident because I believe I'm a child of God. I am humble because I believe that everyone else is too." She says that confidence and humility are two sides of the same coin. They go hand in hand. She says, "If I am humble but lack confidence, if I am humble but do not have confidence, it is because I have not accepted that there is a divine spark inside me. It means that I don't believe in the miracle, that I was made by God for a purpose all my own. And so I am worthy of the space that I occupy on this earth. And that as a child of God, no one deserves more respect, more joy, or more peace than I, just because I'm a child of God." And then she says, "Thankfully, there is nothing I can add to that title, child of God. Nothing I can add to that title to make it more impressive. There's also nothing I can do to lose the title. I am confident not because I'm pretty or smart or athletic or talented or kind. Those things can change and be given or taken. I'm confident simply because I'm a child of God." Everyone here can have such confidence. There is nothing we can do to add to this title. There's nothing we can do to add to the title child of God and make it more impressive. There is nothing we can do to lose the title. The title is unearned, unmerited gift. It is by God's grace that we have the title. The other side of the coin is humility. Our author says that humility is tricky. She says, like when I write an essay about humility and then spend the rest of the day wondering whether it might actually be the best humility essay ever written by anyone in the history of the world. And she says, "I am confident. If I am confident but not humble, it is because I have not fully accepted that everyone has the same amount of God in her or him. I'm a child of God, and so is everyone else. Be confident because you're a child of God. Be humble because everyone else is too." All of this calls to mind a passage spoken by Nelson Mandela although not original to him, some of you, maybe all of you have heard it. It's from his inaugural speech as he became president of South Africa in 1994. If you remember the context, apartheid has ended, and after 27 years in prison, Mandela is released from prison and elected president. In his inaugural speech, he says the following. He says, "Our greatest fear is not that we are inadequate, but that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light, not our darkness, that frightens us. We ask ourselves, who am I to be brilliant or gorgeous or handsome or talented or fabulous? Actually, who are you not to be? You are a child of God. Now, playing small does not serve the world. There is nothing enlightened about shrinking so that other people will not feel insecure around you. We were born to make manifest the glory of God within us. It is not just in some, it is in everyone. And as we let our own light shine, we consciously give other people permission to do the same. As we are liberated from our fear, our presence automatically liberates others." Nelson Mandela. We were born to make manifest the glory of God within us. It's not just in some. It is in everyone. You were born for that. Born to make manifest the glory of God. Those being baptized today are born for that. Playing small does not serve the world. Let your light shine. We are an epiphany people. We are created in the image of God, marked as Christ's own forever, to participate in God's dream. All in the name of the Holy Trinity, one God, in whom we live and move. Amen.